Professor Richard Dawkins is with us. He has a new book out, The British Ethologist, Evolutionary Biologist, and Author. The work that he's probably the most famous for is The Selfish Gene, but he's got a new book out called The Magic of Reality, How We Know What's Really True. I interviewed him last week on television. If you'd like to see that extended interview, you go to conversationswithgreatminds.com. Professor Dawkins, welcome.
Thank you.
Great to have you with us on the radio program here. Your book, The Magic of Reality, How We Know What's Really True. One of the things that you mentioned last week or the week before when we spoke was this sense you used the word spirituality, as I recall, or maybe I did, and you picked it up. And associating that with science in a way that disassociates it from religion. Can you riff on that a little bit? Because I think that that's a piece of, you know, the magic of reality, is it not?
Yes. We don't want to have anything to do with anything supernatural. And so the word spiritual is a bad word if it suggests the supernatural. It's a good word if it suggests something poetic, something wondrous, something wonderful, which, of course, science gives us. And if you look at the universe, look at the world, look at life through the eyes of science, then it is wonderful, it is poetic, but it's just not supernatural, it's natural. The natural is wonderful, the magic of reality.
And for many people who don't understand science, they don't understand the natural, it may seem supernatural, right?
That's right, but to call anything supernatural is just an admission of defeat. It's a cowardly admission.
All right.
We have to treat it as natural and say if we don't yet understand it, we need to work a bit harder.
Great. Okay, so let's get into some of the chapters. The first chapter of the book, I believe, was who was the first person?
The second chapter,
okay.
And it has a slightly paradoxical answer. There never was a first person because it was all very gradual. And nowadays we call ourselves Homo sapiens, and we call our ancestor, the previous species, Homo erectus. But there never was a moment when Homo erectus parents gave rise to Homo sapiens child. It was all much too gradual for that.
Mm-hmm. And it goes all the way literally back to the assembly of DNA.
It goes all the way back via things that look like monkeys, things that look like lemurs, things that look like shrews, things that look like fish. And there's a rather dramatic moment in the book where I ask you to imagine your 185 million greats grandfather, and you turn over the page, and there is a fish.
Yeah, yeah. And how do you? I'm curious your thoughts on why, in the United Kingdom, there is a, and not just the United Kingdom, not just your country, but most of the developed world, there's a broad acceptance of science as, you know, pretty solid stuff. And here in the United States, the fact that science is it's always an ongoing process of inquiry. I mean, very rarely is science settled. There's always some element of inquiry to it. And the hard right and the religious right in this country has seized upon that to say things like, well, evolution is not, it's still an open question. Global warming is still an open question.
Yeah.
There are still questions. You know, tobacco causes cancer. It's still an open question.
Yes. Well,
how did that happen here?
The United States is the foremost scientific country in the world. There's no doubt about that. The greatest science goes on in this country. But also, the United States, paradoxically, houses a mega dose of anti-science, anti-intellectualism. It is a quite astounding fact that more than 40% of the American people believe that the world, the universe, is less than 10,000 years old. A quite astonishing error. And that lives side by side with some of the greatest scientists in the world, who, of course, know that the world is 4.5 billion years old and the universe is nearly 14 billion years old.
I'm curious your take on if you've had an opportunity to review the science, and perhaps not. I think it's just in the last week or so that they've come out and said that the universe is not only expanding, but it's expanding with increasing speed, and apparently there is some sort of dark matter that has greater power than gravity to...
Well, you'd have to ask a physicist about that. I'm a biologist, and
okay.
So what I would say would be purely an amateur view. But it does go to show how exciting science is, how fast-moving science is, mm-hmm. and how science is prepared to change its mind when there's new evidence.
Right, yes. And this is one of the extraordinary things about science. In the book, toward the end of the book, you address the question, one chapter, why do bad things happen to people, another, why do good things happen to people?
Well, of course, it's just really, why do things happen?
Yeah.
And there's no particular reason to single out bad things or good things, except that people do single them out. There's a sort of weird sense of natural justice that people think somehow it ought to be the case that bad things happen to bad people and good things happen to good people. Of course, the universe doesn't care who's bad and who's good. It's indifferent to us. So things just happen. And bad things may happen to bad people or to good people.
What do we teach our children about the world and why?
Well, we should teach our children the truth about the world, which is science is always the best approximation to the truth we have. Science is improving. It's going to change. We'll know more in the future. What we should not teach our children about the world is mythologies, traditional beliefs that have no basis in fact, so-called revelation that has even less basis in fact. We should teach children to assess evidence and only believe that which is supported by evidence.
Should we not teach our children about Santa Claus?
Well, that's a rather trivial issue. I don't worry too much about that. I suspect, on the whole, it might be better not to. I suspect that children should be grateful to the people who really do give them their presents rather than a mythical being.
Sure.
But I don't feel very strongly about that. I don't want to go to the stake for that.
I actually feel strongly about it because I remember when I was 5 or 6, I don't remember how old I was, but I remember when I learned that there wasn't, and it was a crushing experience.
Yes, well, it is for some children. What's rather weird is that they understand that they've been duped all along about Santa Claus,
yeah.
But they still go on believing in God, even though that's an even bigger duping.
Yeah, a very specific anthropomorphic Bronze Age God who keeps a list and is willing to have amnesia if you perform the right ritual.
Yeah, he's a deeply unpleasant character.
In many ways, yeah. Although, there have been some attempts to reinvent him or her in positive ways, I suppose. But
yes.
So in the minute we have left, we're talking with Professor Richard Dawkins. His new book is The Magic of Reality, How We Know What's Really True. What, in your mind, is the major carry-home message of the book?
The truth is wonderful. The truth is magical in the best sense of the word, and that we find out the truth by the methods of science, which are the methods of looking at the evidence and evaluating it critically.
And we do that methodically over time, and it grows and adapts? I mean,
yes.
You know, science in the 16th century was very different than science today.
That's right. Science learns from its mistakes and is approximating ever closer to the truth.
This is the classic, we stand on the shoulders of giants.
Shoulders of giants,
yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Isaac Newton.
That's right, it was Isaac Newton, yes.
Yes.
And then paraphrased later by actually a number of people, including Jefferson. Professor Richard Dawkins, richarddawkins.net is his website. His new book, The Magic of Reality, How We Know What's Really True. Sir, thank you for dropping by today.
Thank you very much.
Very good talking with you, and a very fascinating book, a wonderful book. This is the kind of book that if you want to introduce your kids to the extraordinary magic of science,